I never knew you would favor me this way. You've turned this life around. My name is Celestine Donkor, and this is my one-on-one with GhanaMusic.com. My name is Celestine Donkor. Actually, my full name is Celestine Mousy Donkor. And I come from, my mom comes from Anyaku in the Volta region. And then my dad comes from Togo. So part of me is Togolese and part of me is Ghanaian. But the fact is that I'm 100% Ewe. I speak Ewe, primarily. I speak Twi, I speak Ga, I speak English. These four languages, trust me, I speak them very well. I also write as well. I write Twi, I write Ga very well. At a point, I was even a Ga teacher. I imagine an Ewe being a Ga teacher, yeah. When you are born in Accra and you have lived in a compound house, you have the privilege to learn a lot of languages. So yeah, I speak four languages. Okay, yeah, I belong to one interestingly exciting family. My parents had 15 of us. 15, yes. And the same, those of us from the same dad and same mom, are 12. And then I have half siblings, three of them. And so I am a seventh born. Whichever side, I'm a seventh born. And it's an exciting family, more men than women. Nine men, and then we have six women. And the family is entirely talented. Somebody plays keyboard, somebody sings, somebody's a pastor. And we are all into this music and ministry stuff. So everybody's connected to, one way or the other, to ministry. And we have a photographer, we have engineers, studio engineers. And so that is the family I belong to. And we are all grown up now. I think every year we meet at home. We all come home with our wives, husbands, and children. You can imagine it's a very large gathering. And that is when we are really of ourselves. We really joke and we eat our mom's food. Like once in a year, you get to come back and eat your mom's food. So it's exciting. And my dad is late. He passed on 2 years ago. But they raised us up in the fear of the Lord. Church has been part of our upbringing, and we mostly from house to church and something that has to do with church. So that is how we grew up. Interestingly, I happen to have a different life from my siblings. I don't know, but somewhere, somehow, I grew up living with people. At a point, I remember, right about my teenage, I had to leave home to help somebody who has given birth and needed an extra help at home. So my mom, because we are many at home, is just easy for her to just let us go. We'll go and help this woman for like a week. And that became my life. And I end up living with a lot of people, different families, as a house help. Interesting experiences, when it comes to that. Yeah, so that has been my life, my family. Okay, education. My parents, though they were not really on top of their finances, they made sure that they did their best, honestly, to take us to school. So it wasn't a struggle for my primary education. But when I got to JHS, I mean transition from JHS to a senior high school, that was where the problems began, because it wasn't easy for my parents. And like I said earlier, we are many. So I remember very well, I chose Laboni Secondary School as my senior high school. That was my first choice. And then when I went to check, my name was on the list. I mean, it was exciting to know. But when they gave us deadline to pay the admission fee and all that, my parents couldn't raise the funds. So, and interestingly, I think I was the best, second best in my region. I attended Saito morning and afternoon school. So I was the second best in my region. I attended Damboy, JHS, St. Augustine Preparatory School. Those of you who live at Abeka and Flattop area, you know that school. So all my peers were going to secondary school. And those who had 32 and 39, 36, and we used to laugh at them. But I mean, look at me, the best student in the school is not getting school. It's not able to raise admission fee. It was really one of the toughest times of my life as a young, as a teenager. And I remember very well, my mom used to hold my hand and pray with me, and she would encourage me, but it wasn't easy to see your peers entering school and you are not. But eventually, I enrolled in a new school, which was not part of my plan. It wasn't what I wanted. I really wanted to be in Laboni because all my elder siblings went to Laboni. But then I saw this, because we didn't raise the admission on time. I didn't have a choice. We saw this new school advertised on TV in Sanya Secondary School. And at the time, my mom was able to raise the money. So it was left with like 3 weeks or 4 weeks for the first term to end. But she insisted, like, I have to go. So she put me in Sanya Secondary School. And that was where I had my secondary school education. I went on to the University of Ghana. I read information studies and linguistics. I actually love to work with people. And sociology helps you to understand human behavior and how people behave the way they do. So, some way, somehow, I just love to work with people, to understand people. And because I grew up in the church and part of my life is ministry oriented. So it gave me the opportunity to understand that every human responds to whatever the action they give is a response to a prayer action. Information studies because I love technology, and then I love, you know, organizing stuff. So yeah, that course caught my interest. Which language do I relate to most? Of course, it's Ewe language. I mean, it's interesting that I wasn't nurtured in the Ewe land, but trust me, I desire it. I am so attracted to the language. I love the way it sounds. It sounds very unique when you put it in music. And when I'm singing and it gets to the other part, you can feel that my soul is there. So yeah, I love the Ewe language. For me, it carries anointing. I always say the language itself is anointed. Yeah, it's heavy, you know. I used to joke that when you meet the devil, don't speak in tongues, just speak Ewe. Learn two heavy Ewe words and speak it. It sounds like tongues. Then a small animal like cockroach, we call it agbagbladja. So you can imagine it's a heavy language. I love Ewe to the core. Where did music start for me? Let me just go back a little to say that I was and I am that brilliant student in class, like always on top. And when my friends are watching this right now, they can attest to this. Like, I'm never second in class from primary one to whatever. I'm always on top of the class. And anytime my teacher is writing, they finish the report, you see all the subject first, and overall position first. But when my teacher is writing the teacher's remark and where the interest of the student is, he writes, loves singing. So I didn't realize that singing was part of me. I just love to sing. And I sing everywhere. But later on in my life, I got more interested in singing. But I never planned it to be a profession. Because like I said, I was brilliant and I believed that I could achieve anything. If there was anything that I desired to become was some serious businesswoman, teaching business, in a very high profile level. And that was what I desired to become. I felt like I could be someone who can train, who can teach people to succeed. Yeah, so that was an inner desire, something I wanted to do. But interestingly, music just took me by surprise when one day I was still in school in my final year, when a friend of mine asked me to escort her to the studio to record her song. I was just going to accompany her, hold her bags, buy her water, and do errands for her. I wasn't going to even record. Before that encounter, I sing everywhere, like in church, at school. Anywhere I go, people know that this is the lady who sings. I escorted this friend, and she was recording in the studio and singing. And I was at the reception just waiting for her. And while she was singing in the studio, I was also singing along at the reception. And then the studio, the sound engineer was, once in a while, he would take a glance at me, and I observed it, and I kept singing. So after the whole thing, he approached me, that's the engineer, Mr. Fred Chaymanson. And it was like, you have a great voice. You sound very good. Would you like to record? And I'm like, yes. I've never been to the studio. That was my first time. And he said, okay. So he booked a night for me. And then we met. I didn't know how to write a song. Nothing. So when we got to the studio, he just started playing the keyboard. And he said, I should sing anything that comes into my mind. So interestingly, I was shocked at what I sang that night. And that very night, we wrote our first song. And that day was the beginning of that awakening in me that music is part of me and I need to take it seriously. So that is how this whole thing began. Fredima actually discovered my voice in that reception, gave me the opportunity to record in the studio, helped me to try my hands on writing a song, and actually made me hear my voice on a recording for the first time. He did it all for me. Yes, since then, you know when things come to you on a silver platter, you take them for granted. Everything happened so quick before I realized my first album was, ready to be launched. And I didn't know anything about owning copyrights, whatever, notes, nothing. I was just a novice. I didn't know anything. So I think Fredima pretty took advantage of that though, by the way. So I was just running along and singing and enjoying it. We launched the first album. For me, that was the end of it. I didn't know whether you need to push your song to get it to the top and to get attention. I have no idea of those things. So I dumped this album that I launched somewhere. For me, it was Fredima's work. That was what I thought. And later on, a guy approached me in church. Apparently, he came to the album launch and he bought one CD. So he came to me and he was like, I've been looking for you, Celestine. I bought your CD at your lunch and this particular song saved my life. And I was like, what happened? He said he attempted to kill himself, but he mixed something that is used to kill rats. He mixed it and he wanted to drink it because he was frustrated about some things in life. But just before he took the concoction, he decided to play a song. And apparently my CD was already, in those days, it wasn't even CD, it was tapes. My cassette was already in his tape. So he just pressed play. And the part of the song that says, that was what came out. It was so loud. According to him, he had an encounter through that song. And as I speak with you, he's still alive. He changed his mind from dying. And one thing he said that gave me a turning point was that, Celestine, this is what your song has done for me. If you are not taking your music seriously, begin to take it seriously. So that was the next point of my life where I began to follow after the music. The first recording experience came to me on the silver platter. But the point that I decided to actually take this as what God has given me, work on it, pray about it, and be interested in the impact to make in the lives of people, this testimony actually changed my mind. My role model has always been Jane and Beres. It's so sad that in Ghana, it's so sad that... let me answer this question again. My role model, when it comes to Ghana or Ghanaian musicians, has always been Jane and Beres. I just connect to their music. Especially, I think Beres. She most of the time she writes songs. There's no song of theirs. The ones they promote and the ones they don't promote. There's no song from Jane and Beres that I don't know. Like, I learned their song to every level. So if there's anybody that I've drawn a lot of inspiration from, it's Jane and Beres. But outside Ghana has been Rebecca Malopi. I don't understand anything about what she sings, but I just connect to the soul that I hear from her singing, and it has really impacted my life because I listen to a lot from Rebecca. And then it generally gave me interest in going after African music. So if you listen to my songs, the impact is, there's always something that has African touch, South African touch, even when I'm doing it in Ghanaian language. I actually deliberately did not do that. But what happened at a point in my life was that when, because it was Fredima, who is an engineer, who discovered me, he also gave me the opportunity to be backing some artists in the studio, because he just loved my voice and he gave me that opportunity. So I realized that I backed a lot of gospel artists, as in singing their choruses, and then secular artists at the time. It was like that studio backing girl experience. So I was just backing anything that comes to the studio and I have opportunity to back. And for me, I didn't actually choose whether to back gospel or to back secular, as long as it's paying. And trust me, that time backing really, really paid. It really, really pays. You back one song and it's like, in those days, 50 Ghana. And then I'm talking about 2004, there about 50 Ghana for a track. And you are doing like 10 to 12 tracks. And this goes on like every day. So it really gave me a lot of money. I was backing gospel and secular songs. But again, going back to that testimony, made me sit down to actually reflect on what I want to do, whose side I want to be on, who I want to project with my song. And from then on, I decided to strictly do gospel, because if there is anything I want my voice to project or my voice to draw people's attention to, it is Christ and nothing more. That was a personal decision. Yes, there is a great future for the gospel. Statistically speaking and reality speaking, gospel music actually have a future. And I'm saying this because, I mean, look at the church fraternity in Ghana alone. everywhere you go, there are churches everywhere. And that is our target audience for gospel music. And so the more the churches are expanding, the more hope there is for the gospel music. So I would say there is future, just that we need to grow up in our packaging, our presentation, and a lot of other things. And the reason why secular guys are loud, because they are not scared, they take risk, and they are not afraid to be open. But I mean, they talk about anything, they wear anything, they will do anything to get attention. But a gospel artist, you are kind of restricted. If you want to stay relevant for long, you need to be careful and mindful of who the people, or what the people want to see in a gospel artist. And you must really represent the gospel and represent it in excellence. And that is what I see. So we can't put both on the same level, because a secular artist can just wear bikini, take a picture, put it out there, and the next moment people will be talking about, you know, a single the person has released. And but a gospel artist, what can you do? Your voice, the anointing you carry, and the quality of what you are bringing out is what you count on. But there is hope for the industry, because we are highly religious nation. And I mean, people everywhere, after a lot of dancing, you want to relax and reflect on some music that will speak to you. So there is hope. There is hope. I wouldn't say it's bad. There is hope. Yeah. The choice for Gideon, I would just say, it's God's perfect time and divinely arranged something, because I didn't know Gideon from anywhere. People think he's my son. He's my son now anyway. But I didn't know him from anywhere. And I wrote Agbebolo 3 years ago. And I usually, when I write my song, I sing at church. Because I always say that all the songs I write, I may not be able to release them on an album, on a record, before I die. So anytime I get a song, I start rehearsing with my team and when we minister at church and all that. So I've been ministering this Agbebolo song in my church. It's actually my church's favorite. I mean, ICGC, Destiny Temple, they know this song. So at the time that I decided to actually go to the studio to record, that was just the time I saw this guy, Gideon, on one of these reality shows, Talented Kids shows. And he actually sang one of my songs on the show, Okonkwohene. And when I saw the video, I wasn't even in the country by then. People sent me, check out this guy, he's singing your song. And when I saw the video, I'm like, wow, this is awesome. This is a talent that needs to be heard. So just around the time, coincidentally, I was about to record Agbebolo. So it just happened. I said, Gideon, I need to put you on this song. And I wrote his part for him, and he nailed it. So that was how it came. I think it's just the doing of God. Like I said, when I write songs, I do it in my church first. To see their reactions, their response, and it helps. And sometimes too, after recording, I have a lot of good music persons, industry persons, who I give the song to them to listen and make their comments. So it also helps you to know that a song would do well. But there are songs that, right from the writing on that spot, you know that God has given you this song for, to do something, to make some impact. Yeah, that is also there. So a little bit of here and there, you're able to know. Who I want to collaborate with, a lot of people, Tasha Cops, Travis Green, Evelyn Wanjiru from Kenya, Eunice Injeri from Kenya, Joel Dwaga from Tanzania, and a lot of people. Yes, all these people I've mentioned, I mean, I love them and I would like to have something with them. How did I build an international network? It's God, though. These things, is God, it's season and time. But I think Celestial Praise events really came to establish some international connection to my ministry. And because I took a bold decision to involve some international singers, I mean, outside Ghana on my event. And when they come, I mean, we do our best to make them feel celebrated in Ghana. And it has really opened up a network, because when they come to Ghana and they see what is happening, by the grace of God, Celestial Praise is doing absolutely well. I mean, we've hosted over 7,000 people in one sitting, like in one event. And cumulatively over the years, we have done the 8th edition now. We can say we've gathered like 20,000 people. So when they come to Ghana and they see this thing, the excellent, the stage, the lights and everything on point, it kind of, you know, open up a relationship. They also want to bring you there. And that was how it all began. But trust me, it's just God and the season and time God does. You see, because sometimes the invitations I get, sometimes the countries, I don't even know how to pronounce the name. There's one I got recently from Utashios. I had to Google to know where that country is. So it's just God, trust me. In the next 5 years, I believe that people will be, everybody will be singing Celestine Donkor music. Celestine Donkor music will be in the church. Because the kind of songs I'm receiving these days, they are, I don't know what God wants to do, but they are very great songs. And I believe that it has come to, I mean, revive something out in the church, so in the lives of people. So in the next 5 years, I think a lot of children will be learning Celestine Donkor songs, and locally and globally, the presence of, I mean, the Celestine Donkor music will be far bigger than what it is now, because that's the direction, and we believe God that He will take us there.
To go into your future, mm-hmm. to go and look at what will happen in your future, that's why you prepare for it. Another opportunity to go into your past, to change something that happened in the past.
I prefer to look into my future. I am a forward person. I don't rely on what is gone. Not even something that happened in the last 1 hour. I like to always look forward.
Alright. Now, you have the chance or the choice to lose your singing voice or your ability to write songs. Which one would you choose?
Which one would I choose to lose?
Yes.
My ability to write and my ability to sing. I'll choose the one to lose.
You choose the one that you keep, the one that
should. I'll keep my ability to sing, because when I don't know how to write, I can borrow, you know, the services of people who write, and I'll sing.
It's your favorite meal. It's the last meal you have to eat after you're 100 years old. You eat, you sleep, and you go to your meal.
That one is a workplace. You see this one? I didn't think about it. That one is a workplace and Ademedechi, my mom's recipe, not from any other source. I mean, this is what I take on my birthday, on special days of my life. So yeah, number one, a workplace and Ademedechi.
Okay. So you told us you have 15 siblings.
Yeah.
Can you tell us your favorite among them? Give them a shout
out. Hey, you want them to kill me? My favorite, is my brother Michael. Interestingly, I just like him. I like his passion, and he loves achieving big things even with a young, I mean, age. And I like that about him, and I pick a lot of things from him.
Now, name a country that you wish to visit. You know, one country. that you wish people missed?
Australia. I like God to give me things that people say are impossible. I hear people say a lot that getting Australia visa is a big deal and all that. And I like to dare God to give me big deals. Yeah, so for just that reason, I will enter Australia before I die.
So you have the choice to pray for 40 hours or fast for 40 days.
I'll fast for 40 days continuously because I've done that before and it'll help me lose weight. Yes, so I'll choose the fasting.
So, best performance that you've ever had?
Best performance that I've ever had? It was in Kenya at Praise Atmosphere 2019, yeah. It was, I don't know, that performance video came out and in a week it had 1 million views. I was shocked. I don't know what I did. But I watched the video and I realized that I was really in connection with the audience and I loved it. Yeah.
Worst performance
was recently at the launch of 3 music awards. The sound was bad. I wasn't hearing anything on stage. I ended up even getting emotional and saying things I shouldn't have said. So it's 2020. That is my worst.
Do you like animals,
like pets? I like birds. When I see them in cages, I love them. I buy them all the time. They fly away. I don't know why. I love birds.
So, tell me your favorite gospel song
while you're doing it. My favorite gospel song.
You sing just the 9 words.
Adishimo jebi ebienanua Ekanyema Odio sama susu acheyenkwa Odia kukudro koe janenimu. Jane and Bennis, my favorite.
What irritates you the most in life?
I think I won't tell you. Pride. It disgusts me when somebody is proud. I don't like people who show off. I mean, who try to make belittle people. And yeah, I don't like it.
Right. Supposing you have some magical powers, that's when you could be holy.
Hey, come again.
Supposing you have some magical powers, someone wants to vanish, someone wants to fly, someone wants to show you, someone wants to come again. Your magical powers can do anything. Choose one. What would be your favorite?
I would like to be invisible. Yeah. To be at places where no one can see me. Like I'll see this.
Okay.
Let me rehearse my tongue. Celestine Celestial Praise raises electoral grace. Celestine Celestial Praise raises electoral grace. Celestine Celestial Praise raises electoral grace. Celestine Celestial Praise raises electoral grace.
If you want to music, you'll be a rapper.
I got that one.